just a brief introduction about this particular track. So the objective behind the strategy track is not to talk about WSO2 products a lot, but rather to tell how we have looked at certain things from a strategic point of view. Of course, we'll take some of the WSO2 examples, but these are more of strategic points you need to know when it comes to different aspects. So in my talk, I will focus mainly on the API strategy. So to begin with, let me ask you, how many of you guys don't have an API within your enterprise? Don't have an API? OK. Yeah, OK. I'm sorry, but like I didn't mean to. So some of these experiences, I happen to work with a product called WSO2 API Manager, which some of you may have heard of. And like most of the things that I'm going to share are experience that we have learned over the time by presenting the API Manager to the customers and learning how they are using the API Manager and how we have formulated our strategy around introducing APIs to customers. So to start with, whenever a customer comes to us, this is the question that we ask. Whenever a customer comes to us asking, inquiring, okay, we need to have an API, and tell me how your platform can help us, right? First of all, we ask, why would you want to have an API, right? Or how do you want to have an API, right? Now, these are some of the questions that we ask, right? Do you want to have a public or a private API, right? So now, this is actually a question where like most of the customers will have a clear answer. So when customers come to us, so they say, okay, we have different departments, and between departments, we want to share things. And right now, like things have been duplicated. Different departments don't know like what each and every other department is doing. So they need to have an API, so private APIs. Or else, some of them want to like go public, expose things, right? Say for example, a good example is one of our clients, StubHub. It's they are a US-based ticket. Basically, they are into ticketing business, ticket and event management business. And when they came to us, like they had this requirement where like they want to expose their capabilities as public APIs so that developers can pick them up and write applications, right? And then there are customers like who has a business and want to expose an API as part of extending their business. And then there are customers who API is their product. That is the only thing. So for example, in the case of StubHub, they actually like had their own ticketing business, right? And they just wanted to expose an API, a public API, so that they can expand their business. Okay? Whereas if you take a customer like Apiculture, they are a Spain-based linguistic company. Their main product is the API. They basically sell linguistic services via APIs. So a question that you should be asking. And who's your target audience? In the case of one customer, their target audience was external developers, so that developers can pick the APIs and write applications and expand their business. There are other customers like who are their target audience is internal developers, so their target is reuse. And you need to define the outcome. So that is tightly related to this one, why, but the outcome, what you expect out of it. Now, in the case of internal departments, it could be that they want to reuse certain things, they want to reduce the time that they do things over and over, or else it could be revenue. Generating revenue. So like, if it is revenue, like this is a pretty good presentation done by John Mazur. If you guys haven't seen this, just Google it. There's actually a different version of it, of this only introduces 20 models. But there's quite a few models that are available. Like he kind of explains very famous systems like Amazon, eBay, Netflix, Twitter, Google, all those APIs, and to what category they fall under, and how they are generating money or other objectives. So define your outcome, define the expected outcome. Could be revenue, could be getting more developers, could be creating awareness, having a marketing campaign around it, right? It could even be like changing your underlying infrastructure, but still allowing the business to continue so that there'll be a unified interface, and which allows you to decouple it from the underlying infrastructure or the implementation so that you can do all the refactoring that you want to do. And the third part of the lesson or the strategy is API is only the front facing part of it. Right? Most of the times when customers come to us, like they want to expose an API, like they already have their business logics done. They already have their internal systems done. Right? Back in 2007, I remember Kaiser Permanente, US-based healthcare provider, they came to us and they told that they have this clinical and patient data that they have accumulated over time, and they want to expose part of it in a very secure manner to some of the doctors, so that these hacker-type doctors can write their own applications to manage their own patients. This is 2007, right? We were not talking about API economy at that time, right? But still, the need was there. They already had the systems, right? So in order for you to achieve this particular step, or to be successful in creating the API, you need to focus on the internal integrations. Different systems are having different parts of the data or part of processing. So in order for you to expose those as a comprehensive set of APIs, or clear set of APIs, or beautiful set of APIs, you need to have that internal integration sorted out. Right? So if you are looking for a vendor that allows you to create APIs, right, that vendor should have integration capabilities, not pitching WSO2, but should have integration capabilities, because API is just only the front-facing part. So some of the typical things, customers have services that they have done, when the service-oriented architecture is very famous, right? And now they want to expose those as REST services. Something, a very common question that we get, we have our set of SOAP services, how do you advise us to expose those as REST-style resources, right? Or else, if you have facade, where they want to, they have their internal systems that are maybe accepting CSV or something proprietary, but they want to come up with latest style of APIs. So how do you bridge the gap? How do you do mediation? Right? So focusing on the integration is something very key, and I listed that out as the third option. And now, this is in alignment with your objective, right? Let's say if it is getting your internal things into set of APIs, the next most important thing is advertising about that, so that other departments, other members, everybody knows about what you have accumulated, what you have collected together. Same case goes with public APIs. Let's say if you want to expose your product or capabilities as APIs, and if you want people to pick it up and write applications or be aware of it, you need to advertise, right? So there are different ways of advertising. So if it is something internal, it could be their internal dashboard, or you can build up your own API portal, and of course have things like campaigns where people have competitions, where people have to write something around the APIs, be creative and blog about it. So different ways of advertising your APIs. So this then again an example from StubHub. Right, so when we talk about WSO2 side of it, our API management story has an API portal, right? And why I took this here is they took the API manager, the API manager's portal, but they had their own theme. They wanted to do it in their own way, and they chose us about like 3 years ago. And at that time, we were not sophisticated enough to like provide all of these instructions. So what they did was like on top of our API portal, they gave their own instructions to their own developers on how to get started. And their API portal actually was only started here. Right? Now, then the other customer is this Apiculture, the linguistic guys. So they also came up with their own like theming, own styling, etc. And they themselves came up with their own pricing strategy, right? On top of what we had. So different ways of advertising APIs. Now in this case, they just directly chose to expose the APIs, right? Whereas in this particular case, they took a different approach where like they were kind of like guiding the developers on what they can do, so that it will naturally move them to the next level, API reference, and do things. Yeah, this. So the next lesson, right, is you have to keep on improving your APIs. Right? So before coming into this particular list, let me just show this particular image. This is actually a slide that I've taken from Netflix, right? And in 2014, they actually took down their public API, right? The reason is they said 11 years worth of public API request equals 1 day of private API request, right? So, if you go back to one of the previous points that I've highlighted, the objectives, right? Now, in this case, they have invested a lot of money, a lot of effort on having the public APIs running, making them ready, having it in a portal, making them secure, right? But what they have discovered is they are getting private API requests more compared to the amount of requests that they get on the public front. And coming back here, the fact that you expose an API isn't end of the world. Like, you can't stop there. You have to keep on evolving, right? And there are different programming paradigms that come, and you have to like adapt to that. So, for example, this is the same reason why Netflix kind of went away from their REST API model, right? And what they did was, previously they had a REST API based model, and they decided, okay, that is not the way forward, because their objective is to, the objective that I'm going to mention is slightly different from what it was mentioned in the morning in the keynote, but their objective is to provide a better user experience at the moment of truth, as mentioned in the morning, on the device that they're having, right? So I could be having a Nexus, somebody else might be having an iPhone, somebody else might be having a tablet, right? Now, each of these devices are having their own expertise, their own capabilities, own set of sensors, right? And each of these devices are capable of providing their own unique experience, right? So rather than, like, what they did here was, rather than having a single generic resource-based API, they just went on to an experience-based API. So they exposed the core capabilities, but anybody who wants to develop a certain Netflix-supported application on top of a particular device can construct their own device, own API, an experience-based API. So what I want to highlight here is you should evolve. The fact that now Netflix is considered one of the best, REST-based APIs. But still, after a while, after going through the statistics, after going through their objectives, motives, they kind of redefined what they have exposed. Okay? So it's not the end of the world. And this itself is a very good introduction into my next topic. 11 years worth of public API request equal 1 day of private API request, which means you should measure. When you have your APIs exposed, right, you should keep on measuring it. You should keep on measuring how they are being used so that you know whether your APIs are actually meeting the objectives. So it could even be like getting into statistics like, say, for example, this is telling global Facebook API users versus international spend share. Something useless, but like just think of like some of the continents who are spending more are also spending a lot of time within Facebook, and like some countries who are not spending that much are wasting, maybe spending a lot of time on Facebook. So like different statistics, or even like this is actually taken from Twitter, like back in 2012. So basically they had this argument whether they really need to invest any time on marketing because they were getting 175 million tweets per day, right? So statistics are very important for you to like measure, to define whether your objectives are really met or should you take a different strategy. Right? So what you should do is like there are four types of statistics that you should focus on. One is like collecting statistics and then like over time analyzing it, kind of an offline analysis. Right? Then online type of statistics where you are like if it involves your APIs on the runtime, if something happens, if something that you want to get notified. Right? So online type of analytics. Then of course, let's say your API traffic goes through a certain route and that particular link is broken, right? So you want to reroute the traffic, type of runtime configuration, do small changes, or let's say like you want to introduce certain promotion activities for an event that is like having a lot of sales within a week, within a day, right? So that's the third form. And the fourth form of statistics is the learning, machine learning type of thing, where you observe certain patterns and figure out like what will happen during next Black Friday or next week. Okay? So should focus on that particular aspect in your strategy. And of course, coming to the seventh one, what you are exposing is your business capabilities. Okay? So what it would mean is you should protect. You should protect your APIs for different things. Now, for example, like if you are allowing your product database to be queried or your orders to be queried, right? What it would mean is, like, you should have all of these measures to protect against SQL injection, XML attacks, JSON attacks, all those built in within your APIs. Say, for example, like in the previous topic we talked about statistics, the fact that somebody is sending you continuous SQL injections should not be considered into the fact that your API is successful, right? So, and you are exposing your business capability, which would mean it's absolutely critical to have these detections in place. And at the same time, the fact that you have exposed a public API and people have developed, or developers have developed an application around it, which means you can't fail, you can't shut down your API. Just imagine what will happen if Google or Netflix or Twitter or like any other popular commercial API shuts down, right? Which means you need to have a failing strategy pre-planned before you deploy. And of course, like have certain measures like different controls so that you will know who subscribed to your APIs at what level. Because public versus private APIs, known set of developers versus unknown set of developers, right? You wouldn't know what will happen. You are exposing your business after all. And of course, if you want your API to be successful, APIs are just an enabler. The purpose of having an API is for people to be creative, people to write applications. That's the sole purpose, right? Which would mean not having a tooling support is absolutely critical for you to meet your objective, right? And like to try out the API, so if you guys, how many of you have used Facebook's API console? Okay, so Facebook offers this nice API console. Actually, there are many APIs that are offering similar things, which you can try out the APIs without writing a single code. So you can invoke certain things, get the response out, add certain parameters, and see how the response changes. So the developer, the set of people that you want to impress more, get an idea of what they can do without writing a single line of code, and go through their idea once more and revamp it or like improve it. And of course, once you have the API, like the planning failing strategy, an operational strategy on how your API is run and what will happen when you want to deploy a newer version, right? Because like, if you can remember in the evolve step, I said the API will always evolve. We should mean you shouldn't have a versioning strategy, right? And there are many times where you run multiple versions of a given API for like backward compatibility reasons, or it could be for different device device support. So things that you have to consider about rolling out a different new version and at the same time deprecating a previous version. Then of course comes legal considerations. What will happen if somebody hacks into the API and extract your business data? What you're going to do? All those things. And what about the SLAs? What if you breach the SLA? What if somebody breaches the SLA when sign up for the API? So different strategical things, not an expert on legal side, so, but at a very high level, something that you should take into consideration. So a little bit about the WSO2 API management platform, right? Now, basically we have, at the core level, we have this particular product called API Manager, which is having the API portal, the key management server, which issues access tokens, and an API gateway, and it also offers basic transformation so that you can expose a REST service and still call a backend SOAP service, or expose a JSON service and still call a unsecured service. Okay? And then we also have our statistical part of it, and this slide is slightly old because right now we are combining these two together, and we offer that as a DAS, data analytics server. And of course, at the extended level, we have our ESP, the mediation engine, and our configuration management repository, the governance registry, and the user management part of it. And this is something like that's very common because most of the customers, like we have our own API portal, but we haven't seen any customer using our API portal as it is. So having that capability is something very important at a strategic level. Yeah, different visualizations that are being supported out of the box. But if you can, you can, of course, write your own stuff. And in the tooling side, I briefly mentioned this. The purpose of having an API is to allow applications to be created. So supporting application lifecycle management within the platform itself, within your strategy itself, is something very key, because that will take you to the next level. So that is pretty much evident on what Facebook is doing, what Twitter is doing. Like say, for example, if you go to the Facebook, if you are writing a Facebook application, they themselves provide the API, the development environment, the deployment environment, everything together, right? So this is something that we are doing with the Eclipse Che, if you have been listening to what Tyler was talking in the morning. Okay, that's pretty much it.